Good morning to everyone. So last class we discussed about what is the purpose of finite element and its application in different various fields, right? Today we will discuss something related to some basics. So what do you mean by an element, and what is the procedure for any solution, so any finite element solution, right? The first thing is, before we start, let us look after what are the elements we have. So when you consider, these are the common types of elements. So whenever I consider a line with two dots, right? So the dot, we call it as a nodes. So the dot, this dot, and this dot, we call it as nodes, right? We call this as nodes. And the center one, the which is connecting this dot, we call this as element, right? So this is a one-dimensional element. So whenever we have a problem related to bar or rod, right? So beam, trusses, frames, all comes under this category, right? So bar problem is what we solve in strength of material, something like this. So let me consider, you have a fixed support, something like this. So your bar, something, I am applying a force, F, right? Axial force. This is a bar problem related to rod. Okay, when the force is acting perpendicular to this, then what happens, it will bend, right? So that is a beam problem. So all this problem can be converted as a line. So we call that as a one dimensional element. Why we call as one dimension? Because the cross section, you see that the cross section is something like this. It will be same. So most of the time. So even if it is different, it will differ based on different types of element, not on other things. So this entire cross section, which is your y direction and z direction, so z and y directions, so that is a constant which you can neglect it, and you consider only the line. Okay, so that is why we call it as a one dimensional element, right? So the next one is a two dimensional element, so which is something like a triangular element, a quadrilateral element, there are some shell plate, something like this. So this problems is whenever you have two-dimensional objects, right? For example, if you are going to analyze your laptop or anything, even a pen, right? So what you can do, I can convert it as a two-dimension, right? So what is the cross section of a particular area, and you solve related to that. Okay, so whenever you convert it, we use these types of elements. So you can able to see that there are, this entire thing is one element. It is not three elements, one, two, three, not like that. This entire thing is one element. It has three nodes. So one, two, so sorry, two and three. Whereas here it has four nodes, one, two, three, and four, right? So only if you consider as a one dimensional connecting one dot, so the two nodes, connecting two nodes, that is one element. When I consider is 2D, connecting this three node or connecting this four node, right? That is one element. So this is one element, this is another element, okay? So these are different types of elements. Similarly, you also have three dimensional elements, so which is something like this. So you can able to see you have one, two, three, four nodes, right? So of course, I think, it's a tetrahedron. So you have four nodes connecting connecting accordingly. So triangles on all the sides. Okay, so it's a three dimension. Similarly here also. So this is also one element, and this another one element. Okay, so this is all we call it as like elements. Right, as I told you, we can able to justify. So the figure what I show in last class, able to see here, this is for 1D. So this is one element, right, connecting these two nodes. Similarly, you have lots of elements here, right? So I think the maximum, it is around 47. I can able to see the maximum number as 47. So you have 47 elements, right? This is one dimensional frame. This is 2D. So you can consider a connecting rod, something like that. So you create small triangles. So you can able to see 1, 2, 3, 4. These are all triangles. So different types of triangles, immersing these things, right? So we are connecting this one. This is two dimensional. So 3D, so this is related to a rectangular element. You can able to see this is one element, this two, something like this, Okay, the main concept in engineering here is to find out which problem is suitable for you, right? So it is not like you can make a mistake always if you solve in a 3D. It is not like that. You can solve a cantilever beam problem in 3D also, of course in 2D also, right? But how you simplify it, right? That is the main cause, right? So the thing is, if I solve in 3D, so the same cantilever beam, so maximum what I have to do, I will calculate what is the deflection, what is the slope, and what is the other things, right? Related to, well, this is the main concept in solving a cantilever beam, right? So if I consider a three-dimensional element, you can solve it, but what happens, it takes lots of memory in your computer, it takes lots of time, right? So the solution, whatever you get, that will be equivalent to your one-dimensional element. So one dimension, you will get in a quicker way, you will get the same solution. So only you are going to identify deflection, the same deflection you will get for 3D also, and of course for 2D also. But how you choose it? So how you identify this element can be used for a particular problem? That is the main thing here, right? So you can solve all the problems in 3D. It is not that there is a limitation, right? So, but you have to look after it based on your processor and based on the other conditions. You should look after and you identify, right? Now, let us consider. So what is the main concept in those things, right? So we call different types of systems. What is happening inside your model? How you are going to identify the model, right? Remember the figure I am showing here, this figure. So splitting these things, you can able to see here, you can see there are larger triangles here and very, very smaller triangles here. And of course, this is also a larger triangle. Can you identify why they are something like this? So these are larger triangles and these are very, very small triangles. Can anyone tell me what is the reason for smaller triangles in this?
Presence of curvature.
Yeah, presence of curvature. Okay, that is good. It also depends on the conditions, how your force is acting, right? So if you feel that this side you have more stress, there's a possibility of higher stress in this particular location, you can make that as more higher number of elements. Okay, so here the concentration of stress is very less, right? In that case, you can eliminate it. So you can make it as a bigger size. So this thing we call it as discretization, right? So this is what we call it as discretization. Okay, because I will come to this term again and again. So converting this as small bits of triangles, we call it as discretization. Okay, so triangles are this even whatever in 3D or 2D, right? Okay, now I will come to this point. So let me consider. So you have a company, a bike company. So a customer is complaining you that they are not having any comfort in your bike. They feel some back pain, right, in your bike. So this is the complaint. So let me consider. So how to solve this? So I am going to consider a physical system for this, right? So let me identify. So I make an engineer, make an analysis. So most of the engineers, they say that it is because of the suspension. So what you identify is you take the suspension, right? Let us take a spring suspension, an open coil spring, and you consider that as a physical system. What you do, you make a mathematical model of that particular spring, identify that, right? So mathematical model is identifying what is the boundary conditions, what is the amount of force it will be acting. So what is the variation in force? All these things comes under mathematical model. So then what you do, you discretize this model. So, okay, we discretize this model. That is what we are converting to elements, right? Mathematical model is a physical model spring. You convert that physical model to elements. That is what we call as discretization. As I told you, there are small triangles, right? So if you solve it in 3D, there will be small bricks, brick type of element. Okay, This one we called as discretization. You discretize that, identify based on the mathematical model, boundary conditions, find out what is the discretized solution. Right? So once you get the solution, what you do? So you have to give a feedback, right? So there may be a solution error, right? So you, how to do that? You will be verifying from your previous datas, right? For the same spring, they all said that this is the answer. So this will be an approximate value you'll be getting. So while you discretize, your answer is not that much equal. So there is lots of difference, right? Which means there is a problem in your discretization, right? What do? You discretize again, right? So you identify what is the error. Again, you redo it, right? So that means I am changing my mesh again. So as I told you, as I saw the figure earlier, so at a particular location, I have shown some, your triangle is a smaller triangle, and some location we have a bigger triangle. Let me consider all are bigger triangles, right? So that is an error. So what to do? I will reduce it. I will make it again into a smaller triangles. All are smaller triangles. Okay, something like that. So that is what? So the error from discretization. Okay, so you identify that error, again you repeating this and you are doing it. Okay, so once you finalize this, there may be a possibility of another error, right? There may be a possibility of another error because of the mathematical model. When I say mathematical model, the engineers has given a wrong boundary conditions, right? Which means your force, whatever they give, is not that much correct force. It is wrong, or the displacement, wherever the constraints, that may be a wrong. So identify that, correct it again. Then when you correct this again, you discretize the same thing which you are already got the best solution. Again, you go for the discretization. Okay, you will get your solution, right? So that is the third error, right? Which is the modeling, physical system is a model. So the real problem is not comfort, right? So the real problem is not comfort. So as per the problem, what we are taken is a spring, right? We analyze it. But still, when you produce this model, when you identify everything, still there is a complaint that it is not comfort, right? It is not comfort. So what it means? What it means? It means that it is not the spring reason. It may be maybe your seat, right? Maybe the seat or the shock absorber, whatever which is available here. So this will be the main cause of the physical system. So again, what you have to do? Again, you have to redo from the beginning, right? This is what which is happening in these things in a computational methods. Okay, so when you go for any model, these are the following errors which will occur because of this particular model. One is because of the meshing. Meshing is what I call it as a discretization. Because of unknown boundary conditions, or because of the main physical system itself. Okay, so only these things will be asked to be repeated again and again until you get a proper solution. Right, this is the real thing what we do in computational methods, right? So these are the things, right? Hope you can understand this. So you can able to see that this is a reversible process. So which one? The mathematical model, physical system, is a reversible process, so which will be has to be repeated again and again. Similarly, the mathematical model and the discretized model, again it has to be repeated again and again, right, until you get a proper solution. Okay, right. So what are the numerical solutions we have? So you have four different types of solutions. One we call it as a finite element method. So whatever we are discussing is a finite element method. The other one is finite different method, which is somewhat based on differential equation. Third one is finite volume method, and the fourth one is boundary element method. Okay, so mostly this finite element and finite volume, both are similar, right? What you do, you take a particular element. So let me consider a triangle, right? You solve what is the answer for this triangle. So you will get nodal points. In this node points, you distribute it for the other triangles, right? So whatever the force you are getting for this nodes, you are connecting it with other elements and you distributing it, slowly distributing it and finding out what is the solution for each and every triangle separately and identifying what is the answer, right? That is finite element method, okay? So it is purely related with elements, right? So elements and nodes, okay? So whereas finite volume is, your element will be what I can say, it's a volume type of element, okay? So we call that as cells, right? We call it as a cells. So our volume, right? You get a brick like volume, something like this. You analyze this volume, right? So how to analyze it? You use your law of conservation of energy theory. So even for element, finite element method, you are using law of conservation of energy theory and you identify what is the relation with respect to this point and this point, with respect to the nodal points, and you distribute it along with that, okay? So that is your finite volume method. So the next one is finite difference method. So this is using differential equations, right? You're using differential equations to solve a particular problem, right? So you take an internal cell, right? You identify what is the strip for this, find out what is the mathematical model in terms of dy by dx, something like that. Solve it, find out and integrate it, right? For the entire term. That we call it as finite difference method, okay? So whereas finite, the boundary element method is only for the boundaries, not inside terms. So what happens here is you, based on boundary conditions, you identify what is the boundary of a particular problem, find out what is your relation with respect to the boundary alone, not inside. Okay, which means in boundary element method, you can't identify what is the data which is inside. Okay, it is only outline data. We will get only on the outline surfaces. So most of the time, these things is eliminated. We won't use it, of course. Difference method is also eliminated now. So mostly we are using finite element and finite volume method. Right, so these are the overall differences when you consider these three methods. So FEM is used mainly for structural flow thermal problems, right? So FEM, finite volume, mainly for flow and thermal problems, right? So FDM, you can use for flow and thermal problems, but the differential equation should be a simple differential equation, right? You can't make it too complicated, right? So here the object equations are discretized into number of points. Here it is discretized to a number of control volumes. Whereas here we have a differential equation like Laplace transformation or harmonic analysis equations or continuity equations. All these equations we will use to identify what is the differential equation, right? So in FEM, it requires higher memory, right? So whereas FVM has less memory. That's why we go for flow problems for this, right? Requires less memory, right? So this also requires less memory, right? So then what is the stability? So how exact the solution you will get, right? So more stable when compared to FEM. So this is in between. So FDM and the FEM, and FDM is the you will get more errors, right? And when you solve the problems, it is capable of lots of interactions. You can interact with fluid and structure. Whatever the fluid pressure, you can apply it for the structure. Based on that pressure, the structure may deflect, right? These things also you can do by using FEM. Whereas FVM, it is difficult to implement, right? So in these two cases, right? So all these things, you have equations related to some sets of algebraic equations integral equations, you can use to solve these things. Okay, so our main thing, whatever we are going to discuss, is FEM. Right, you have an elective for this, which is CFD. So you can use CFD elective to, if you want to learn something related to FVM. FDM you see for unit one also, unit one alone. So unit one we'll deal with this FDM. Okay, right. Okay, so now whenever I say an element, right, what are the main properties of an element, right? So the main property is dimensionality, which means what is the length of my element. So if I consider here, what is the length, right? Next, nodal points, how many points? So you have 1, 2, so this is one element. There are also element like this, 1, 2, 3 nodal points having one element, so we call that as a one element. Okay, this is also one element, right? So this is we call it as a linear interpolation. Whereas this is a quadratic interpolation, right? So what is the difference is whenever you have some curved shapes, right, you can use this types of elements so that you will get more accurate answers, right? So it depends on the nodal points, it depends on the geometry. So which element I have to choose, so whether it's a one dimensional, two dimensional or three dimensional elements. So it depends on the geometry, it depends on the degrees of freedom. When I say degrees of freedom, so when I consider one dimensional element, right, so let me consider there are 2 1 dimensional element, okay, so which is having nodal points 1, 2 and 1, 2. So when I have a problem which is having a force axially, which means your nodal point 1 will have force F1 and it may deflect for U1. Similarly, nodal point 2 will have force F2 and it may deflect to U2. So F1 is the force and U1 and U2. So these things we call it as displacements because of that force. Okay, so which means here the degrees of freedom at this nodal point is 1 DOF. Right, so 1 degree of freedom. Okay, so let me consider your force is acting perpendicular to that, right? Something like a beam. When I consider a beam, what happens? You have a force F1 which will create a deflection Y1, and you also have a moment M1 which will have a slope θ1. Right, similarly here you have F2, right, which will form a deflection, so Y2, and you have a moment M2 which will produce θ2. So when I consider a beam problem, you have a deflection which is dealing with your deflection and slope, right? So a beam deals with deflection and slope, which means your degrees of freedom for one nodal point is 2, right? So whereas here it's 1. So even though the element is looks like same, this is different and this is different. This we call it as a bar element, this we call it as a beam element. Even though it's a one dimensional, the variation is depends on what type of element and how much degrees of freedom you have, right? And of course, what is your nodal forces, how many nodal force at that particular thing, right? You can able to see one node is having only one force, whereas here one node is having two forces. One is a force, another is a moment. It's also a force, right, related to that. So these are the properties, these are the different properties when I consider any element, right? So dimensionality, so length of an element, how many points an element will have, what is the geometry of an element, whether it's a line or a triangle or a brick, what is the degrees of freedom, so how many DOF for a particular node, and what is the nodal forces, right? So these are all the properties for a particular element, right? Any doubt or clarification up to this? Yes. Okay, no. Right. Okay, I will continue. So let us consider what are the fundamental concepts here. So you have a physical system, of course, a governing equation. So you split into different types of problems like elastic problem, which is related to strength of materials, thermal problem, heat and mass transfer, fluid problem, fluid mechanics, or electrostatic, something electrical engineering problems, right? So whatever the problem you have, you identify what is the governing equation for that in terms of dy by dx plus f is equal to zero, right? You can relate it. You can relate all the problems related by using some differential equation, right? So you relate it and you identify what is the boundary condition for this, right? So which side it is fixed, which side it is free, and what is the force which is applied, all these things you can identify. Then you solve this, right? Then you solve this, okay? So you can able to see that this is the problem, right? So which is very, very complicated, right? Which is very, very complicated to solve. All the problems is not possible to solve, okay? So what we do is, so in FEM, we use this stiffness problem, right? We relate everything in terms of stiffness. Right, you know what is a stiffness, right? So stiffness is force by deflection, right? So which means, so I can write what is my force. Force is equal to stiffness, which is K into deflection, right? That is what it is related here. So K is the stiffness, U is the deflection, and F is the force, right? So what I relate here is, I relate everything in terms of the stiffness so that I will get everything in the matrix. So we can easily solve the matrix regarding that. Okay, right. So concept is, we use this formula. F is equal to K into U, right? F is an input, right? So that is the action. So what is the input you are going to give for any model, right? So that is action. K is a property. What type of material it is, right? How, what type of problem it is? Is a one-dimensional problem or a two-dimensional problem or a three-dimensional problem? Your K denotes what is the property. And U is your behavior or output, okay? So you give input, you multiply with your property, right? You will get what is your output. You will get what is your output, right? So this is what we are going to do in this entire subject, okay? We always relate F is equal to K into U, and we will identify, right? So what is the relation with respect to these things? So you can able to see there are two different types of notations here. So you have a flower bracket and you have a square bracket. Okay. The flower bracket indicates it's a matrix. The flower bracket indicates it's a matrix, which is a column matrix. Right? It is always a column matrix. Right? Which is like here, F1, F2, F3, something like this. So it's always a column matrix. Right, whenever I put a flower bracket, it indicates that it's a column matrix. Okay, the square indicates it's a square matrix. So your property or stiffness is a square matrix. It's always a square matrix. And again, this is also a column matrix. Okay, so when I give a input, F1, F2, F3, I will get an output U1, U2, and U3, right? We can relate these things. So for different types of problems, what is your property? What is your behavior? And what is your action? When I consider any, strength of material problem, so your property is your stiffness, right? We have something called as a stiffness matrix. Okay, your K is always a stiffness matrix. Your action is your force. When you apply a force, what do you get? You will get displacement. Okay, so for any elastic problems, this is your properties, right? So your stiffness is your property, behavior is your displacement, and your action is your force. When I consider thermal related problems, your property is a conductivity matrix. It is not stiffness matrix, it's a conductivity matrix. Okay, your action is heat source, right? You are giving heat. What you will get? You will get output. Output is your temperature, right? Output is your temperature. So when I consider a fluid problem, you have a viscosity matrix, right? So, and of course, your action is your body force, and your behavior, your output will be a velocity, right? So if we go for some electrical problems, electrostatic problems, so dielectric permittivity, right? That is your property, your action is your charge, and your behavior, your output will be your electric potential. So everything is always related with this F is equal to K into U, right? Whatever the problem you take, right? You can identify, you can relate everything as a property, and you can relate everything as an action, and you can relate everything as a behavior, right? So that's the main concept in this finite element method, right? Okay. So always your behavior is an unknown factor. So what you'll do, I will cross multiply. So I will get U is equal to K inverse of F, so that I will identify what is my displacement. I will get what is my output. Okay. Right. So next we'll proceed with general steps involved in this finite element method. So what are the steps we are going to follow? Right. So first you have to discretize a domain. So I will explain one by one. So in other slides. Next, you have to select a displacement function. So what type of a function it is, right? So for a particular element, then you define what is your strain displacement and stress strain relation with respect to your element, whatever you choose. Then you derive an element matrix and equate it. Then you assemble your matrix. Last, solve the unknown degrees of freedom and find out what is the stresses and strains. Okay, these are all the steps which is available, so which has to be followed in this FEM, right? We will look after one by one. Okay, I will go to the next slide. So and then interpret. Okay, so let me consider. So first step is discretization of a structure, right? So as I told you, so we have to think about it. So whether I have to consider as a one-dimensional element or a two-dimensional element or a three-dimensional element, right? So how to do that? So these are the ways. Whenever I have a component, so whenever I have a element, when I want to analyze a rod, when I want to analyze a I section, when I want to analyze a tube or some web like something, so all this comes under what you can say one dimensional problems, right? You can consider as a 1D, right? So when I want to analyze something like this, so a dam or something, a square shaped object, a table or a circular shape object, right? So we call this as a plane stress, plane strain and axis symmetry, different types of elements. Okay, so we will be discussing that later. And what do you mean by these things? Okay, so this is all comes under 2D. So you are converting a 3D into a two-dimensional object. Okay, so these are the elements you can use, right? These are the elements you can utilize for these types of objects, right? You can able to see here. So this is one element. Of course, this is another type of elements. Okay, right. So these are all different types of elements. You can use any of these elements, right, to get this particular thing, right? So the next one is 3D, right? So when you have a complex structure, which I can't able to solve, we can't able to convert it into 1D or 2D, then I can able to solve in three dimension, right? So this, you can use a tetrahedral element or a rectangular element. You can able to see, so there are different types of elements here. So whatever the element, you can choose it, right? So the way you choose the element, that is what. So and how much you are reducing it, how the element is reduced, that is what we call as discretization. The first step is you have to do this, right? So in ANSYS we call this as meshing, right? In ANSYS we call this as meshing, right? So you mesh a particular object, right? So that you will get some elements. For next, selection of a displacement function, right? So now I have chosen element. Let me consider. I have chosen a triangle element. As I show here, let me consider. I have chosen a triangle. I am going to solve a two-dimensional problem. So I have chosen a triangle element. In triangle element, there are two types, right? A triangle element. This is also a triangle. So one is this one. So this type one, T1, this type two. Right, both are triangle, but you can able to see that the node numbers is different. So one is having only three nodes only at the corner, the other is having six nodes. So even at the middle it is having. What is the difference? So if I want to transfer the value from one to two, right, if I want to transfer a value from one to two, I use the equation U is equal to A naught plus A1x. It's because it's a linear element. You have only a line. So which means the function to interpolate with respect to one and two. So whatever you want to transfer data from one and two, we use this as an equation, A naught plus A1x. So linear equation, right? Whereas if I consider here, right? So this actually it won't be like this. This element won't be like this. The element, the real element will be like this. So I am drawing here, right? This is my real element. You can able to create a curve, right? So because of this points, extra points, right? So you can able to get a curve. So wherever you have a very, very curvy surfaces, I want to mesh there, I use this type of element. Okay. So this comes under the relation U is equal to A naught plus A1x plus A2x square. It's a quadratic equation, right? So you get something in terms of a quadratic equation, right? So that deals here. That is the difference here. Okay. So we can interpret. Of course, there are elements like this also, something like this. Right, I am right. I am drawing the same thing, but the number of nodes is increasing. So I have two nodes here in between. Right, in between, I have two nodes. How many nodes? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine nodes. Totally, you have nine nodes here. Right, so the equation here is U is equal to A naught plus A1x plus A2x square plus A3x cube. Right, so you are increasing the number of what you can say function, displacement function. We call this as a displacement function. Okay, so which displacement function is suitable, right? That is important, right? So that is important based on different types of approach, right? So usually we call this as two methods, right? One we call it as H method. The other one we call it as P method. P method is increasing the polynomials, right? To increase the accuracy of my result, what I do is, right, I take one triangle, I mesh with one triangle, but to increase the accuracy, I am increasing the polynomials, right? Which means I am putting one more extra nodes inside, right? So instead of linear, I'm going for a quadratic, or I am going for a what you can say cubic, right? This we call it as a P method, right? Increasing the polynomials. H method is instead of increasing the polynomial, I am increasing the number of element. Instead of this one triangle, what I can do, I can make it as a two triangles. Right, this is my point four or four or five triangles. So how many elements? 1, 2, 3, 4 elements are here. Increasing the number of elements to increase my accuracy. That is H method. Right? H method is increasing the number of elements, whereas P method is increasing the number of polynomials. Hope you can able to see the difference, right? So in ANSYS, when you solve, sometimes it will ask you what method you are going to solve, whether you are going to solve it by means of H method or P method, right? So that is the difference, right? So mostly, based on research, it is identified that yes, method is best suitable when compared to P method, right? What happens if you increase the polynomial, your squares are higher. Because of that, the computer takes lots of memory to solve a particular problem, right? Whereas H method is simple, right? So that you can able to easily solve by increasing the number of elements, right? So that is the next thing, right? So of course, I think, I have discussed the same thing here on the slide, you know, experiment. Let me consider you have a fin. This is my output of my fin, right? So when I consider my element, a linear element, which is having only two nodes, right? Which is having only two nodes, my result will be like this, right? Whereas if I have three nodes, your result is somewhat accurate when compared to this. So this is what we call as a P method. So you increase the number of nodes in a particular element, you will get more accurate results. Okay. So of course you can also make it into small, small pieces. So 1, 2, 3, small, 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 small pieces, right? So each element, that is H method. Okay. I explained that in previous slides. So same thing, right? So that is what the selection of your displacement function. So which is step two. Step three, define what is the strain displacement and stress strain relation. Let me consider your one dimensional problem. When I consider a one dimensional problem, I can identify what is the relation with respect to these things. What I can say, you know that your Young's modulus is stress by strain. Okay. So your Young's modulus is related to stress by strain. So which means I can relate. So your stress is equal to Young's modulus into strain. Right? So this is the relation. This is my stress strain relation. Right? Stress strain relation is this. Strain displacement is, you know that strain is du by dx. Right? Which means strain is d by dx of your displacement function u, right? D by dx of u. So this is your strain and displacement relation. So for 1D, I can easily solve because I can directly write what is E, what is your D by dx. So I can easily do for 1D. But for 2D, it is not possible. It is, you will get it in terms of a matrix, right? Even for 1D, so if I want to transfer values from here to here, right? So my 1D element will be like this, right? Will be equal to, I consider this as a stiffness matrix, so which is A by L. We will discuss about this, how this terms comes in later. So just I am writing it, what will be the value? So 1 minus 1 minus 1, 1. So this is my stiffness matrix for one dimensional element. Okay. So when you consider 2D, what happens is there are different types of properties. There are different types of property change. We call it as an isotropic property, right? Isotropic, orthotropic, right? So based on that, you will get different matrices. So based on the particular property, you have to use that as a matrix to identify what is the strain displacement, stress strain relation and strain displacement relation. Okay, so this is what you have to do for the second, for the third step, to identify what is your displacement functions. And the fourth one is to identify what is your stiffness matrix, right? Based on your displacement function, based on the displacement function, I am identifying what is the stiffness matrix for all these things. Okay, so when I say stiffness matrix, as I told you, in previous slide I have shown, right? So K is equal to AE by L 1 minus 1 minus 1 1. This is for a one dimensional element. This is a stiffness matrix for one dimensional element. Okay, so we can use this stiffness matrix to get an equation, right? You identify what is the stiffness matrix for each element, right? That is step 4. Step 5, you identify what is the global stiffness matrix. You are assembling the entire stiffness matrix. For example, you have a cantilever beam here. You split this into two segments. So I will draw an element like this. So you are having element 1, element 1 is having nodal point 1 and 2. Element 2 is having nodal point 2 and 3, right? So I will identify what is the element stiffness matrix for the first element, which is, I'll call it as K11. So what we'll get, I'll get AE by L 1 minus 1 minus 1, 1. Right? So when I consider the second element, again, it is K22. Again, it is also AE by L. If there is a difference, you can change it. 1 minus 1 minus 1, 1. Now what I can do, you can able to see that it is combined together, right? It is combined together. So when I want to assemble this, what happens here is I am assembling like this. So I am getting my overall K matrix, which is relating 1, 2, and 3. 1, 2, and 3. So you have three table matrix. So you have three columns. So when I consider the first element, it is connecting 1 and 2. Right? It is connecting 1 and 2. The second element is connecting 2 and 3. Right? So when you combine these two, I will get AE by L. So 1 minus 1 minus 1, 1. Again, so 2 is connected to element 1 and element 2, right? So again, plus 1. Minus 1, minus 1, 1. So others will be 0, whichever is not applicable. So this is my overall equation, right? Overall equation for these two elements, right? Not so rendu elements, only two elements we used. For this two element, you got 3 cross 3 matrix, right? So remember how many, if I have 10 elements, right? What will be the size of the matrix, right? So 10 means you will get 11 node points. So my matrix size is 11 cross 11 matrix, right? Very, very large matrix. So this is what we call as assembling of this matrices, right? So the next step is you identify what is the unknown solution for it. Right now, I got an assembly, right? I got what is my K matrix. My K matrix is AE by L. What I solved is 1, minus 1, 0, minus 1, 2, minus 1, 0, minus 1, 1. So this is my overall matrix, right? So it is having nodal point 1, nodal point 2, and nodal point 3, right? So when I relate it with respect to that, so what I can say, I will consider. So this is my nodal point 1, nodal point 2, nodal point 3. This is also relating with nodal point 1, 2, and 3. So here, when I solve unknown DOF, so degrees of freedom, this one is fixed, right? So nodal 1 is fixed, which means you don't have U1. U1 is 0, right? Which means I can eliminate that first row and first column. You have only this matrix. So I can able to identify what is my U2 and what is my U3. Right, by using the relation F is equal to K into U, right? So you can relate it, then U is equal to K inverse of F. You can multiply, you will get what is the value of U2 and U3. U1 is 0 because it's a fixed end, it is 0. You can apply it and you can able to identify what is the unknown DOF, degrees of freedoms, right? So once you do that, so then what you can do, you can identify. So once you get U value, I can relate this U value in different terms to identify what is your stress, what is your strain, whatever the value we want, right? So if I want strain, right, it is nothing but, so I can able to identify what is the strain in element one and what is strain in element two. So element one strain will be equal to, so change in what, change in displacement by original displacement. So change in length by original length, that is your strain, right? Change in length is u2 minus u1 divided by original length of this element L, right? You will get what is the strain in element one. Similarly, if I want strain in element two, I'll get u3 minus u2 divided by L, right? So if I want stress, stress is E into strain, right? Multiply with your Young's modulus, you will get what is the stress, right? So these things you can able to do once you achieve what is your value of your U, right? So that is your step seven. And step eight is also interpreting the results. I think I will show it here, right? Solving the stress strain and other things. Okay, that's the last tip, right? So interpreting your results, right? So these are the steps, right? General steps for any finite element method. Discretize, find out what is the displacement function, find out what is the relation between strain displacement, stress strain, find out what is the stiffness matrix, assemble your stiffness matrix, solve the problem, get the solution, right? So these are the things you can able to, this is the usual procedure we are going to follow in FEM.